All right, I think it's recording. We're right in front of it. So, welcome to the first Interlibrary Roundtable meeting. We could probably go around the table and introduce ourselves. I'm April Shaw. I'm here at the Vermont Department of Libraries. I'm the Clover Lady, the Courier Lady, and the Reference Person. So, I love questions.
I'm Christine from Pledger Pre-Library. I back her up on ILL, Catalani, Collections Reference.
I'm May from Essex High School and Center for Technology at Essex Junction, and I do ILL and a lot of other stuff.
I'm Kat Sear. I'm from Middlebury College, living inside of ILL, and I also work at the Public Library, Russell Memorial.
I'm Aiden, I'm just a summer worker.
Frank, I'm from St. Johnsbury afternoon. I'm doing ILL and circulation, but I'm mostly doing Brothers Library.
Jim Mancuso from Northeastern Baptist College down in Bennington. And as a sole librarian, I have to wear all hats. So, Interlibrary Loan is just one of many things I do.
I'm Chris von Hill from Springfield Town Library. I do Interlibrary Loan. I also handle the IT at the library and do reference and some on circulation. And as my job description says, and other duties as assigned.
Hi, I'm Mary Byrne from Tenney Memorial Library, and I am it. I do whatever they and any other duties. Yes.
I'm Kate Beaton from Blue Mountain Union School. I apologize to all of you that I've had to open the books out on. Most of my peers are much more reliable about that than I am. I'm the bad egg.
My name is John Levin. I'm from the School for International Training in Brattleboro. And I do interlibrary loan and other things as well.
I'm Jean Walsh. I'm the reference librarian at Russell Memorial Library in Brattleboro. And I oversee interlibrary loan. And most of you are more familiar with my colleague Jen Ansar, who is our interlibrary loan clerk, who does most of the day-to-day interlibrary.
I'm Joe Vianz. I'm from the UVM ILL department. I am one third of that department.
I'm Lisa Milton from the Norwich Public Library, and I have been doing ILL for 19 years, so I've seen various incarnations of the ILL system, and I do a lot of other stuff too.
I'm Marie Kasparian from the Queechy Library and the Wilder Coleman Library, and I do a little bit of everything all day.
Giselle Stevens from the Paul Library, assistant librarian, and I pretty much do it all because there's only two of us.
I'm Kathy Beard. I'm Director of Adult Services from Norman Williams Library in Woodstock, which means I do ILL and I do supervise all the service staff and anything else.
I am Scott from the Kellogg Hubbard Library in Montpelier. The ILL office is now in the Children's Library, so I do interlibrary loans and I back up the children's desk at all times, and somehow I always get stuck plumbing in the toilet.
It's one of everything. I'm Lee from the office. I'm the host of connecting the ILL and referencing tech stuff.
I'm Kim. I'm from Marcus Library, and we serve the communities of Vermont Technical College and the Community College of Vermont. And I do interlibrary loan there in addition to some service responsibilities and the art gallery.
I'm Joy Worland, and I'm here at the Vermont Libraries. So I've been continuing ed. It's really nice to put names to things. And some of the people we've been emailing about certification, and I also am a consultant for small rural libraries.
I'm Cass Madden. I'm the Youth Services Consultant for the Vermont Department of Libraries.
Hi, I'm Laura Keenan. I'm a consultant for the Vermont Department of Libraries for directors and trustees of public libraries.
Alright, it's back to me. So the wonderfully vague agenda is, I think, broad enough for the group, but it's more about the future of this group, what we want to do with interlibrary loan and resource sharing in this state. I'm leaving the big broad discussion as the middle part. I thought we would start with outlining what our main priorities are, what we want to do with this group, because there's no point in having meetings if you have no action items after you leave. How often we want to meet. And I was hoping that by the end of the meeting we would pick a day and location, or a few possible dates and locations for the next meeting, and that way I could schedule it, you know, next week and everyone put it on their calendars really early. And then the broad discussion topic was, where are we with interlibrary loan and resource sharing in Vermont, and where do we want to end up with it? So, do we want to start with how often we should meet, or what our big priorities are? I think they're kind of related.
If we know what the priorities are, we'll know how good our idea of how often we need to achieve them.
But why the cost of interlibrary loan is not tracked with the borrower, not the lender.
So this is a little bit on a different tangent, but as far as priorities, I think one of the things that we're struggling with, and this is more maybe a philosophical issue, but is that we find we're a net lender and we find that our collection development, like it's really hard to figure out, because we buy with our taxpayers' money for our patrons, and then when it's lent out within a, you know, we do lend out those sort of stuff, and it's out for forever, and then it comes back, and so are we sort of, so there's that part, and the sort of like, are we telling patrons that basically every fad and trend is all, like you're not coming in to browse anymore, you're not, so we're sort of struggling with like where the definition of the library and our collection development, because we're lending more and more and more, but a lot of it is either, I don't know, it's either gone too long or it's you can tell, you know, the latest trend book, and they all go out, but nobody actually, you know, patrons are, do you know what I'm trying to say? Like it's sort of a philosophical question, but are we telling patrons that you can have whatever you want right now, all the time? Whereas it maybe if it wasn't in and you came in, you know, the function of the library is to provide you with a lot more than just that. So we're sort of struggling.
Surveying your community,
yeah.
Just serving the state.
Yeah, and just sort of how does that work for our collection development, you know? So it's maybe more a philosophical issue, but we are a little, like I said, we're a net lender, we want to be, and that's great, but we struggle a little bit with this whole catering to, you know, the latest fad and trend, and as opposed to just exposing people to a lot of different things. So
I don't understand a lot of how it works behind the scenes. I wasn't involved in, you know, when it was being implemented, so I'm not sure what you mean by that.
Oh, so we lend more than we borrow on the interlibrary loan.
Okay.
which is just the way it is.
Statistics. It's
yes.
Not set up originally.
No, it's just how it was happening to come to be over time. And we're a fairly small library compared to some. So
the same in Paula.
Which is great.
Yeah, well, what we do is we just let our patrons come first.
Mm-hmm.
So if we get a great book on the shop, we just tell our person who wants to borrow it.
Right, and we can do that, but that's what I'm saying. It's sort of a
kind of
let it
sit there for a
struggle.
So for our patrons first, and then you guys, then we can ship it out. So let me just ask, so are you saying that the collection development person is it you?
It's you guys.
So you're thinking broader now? I mean, you're not just thinking...
Not really. We like to think about our collection, which, you know, is... but when what we're finding more and more, especially with the ease of interlibrary loan, which is great, is that people are only coming in for, you know, I heard on VPR that this book is great, this is what I want. And if you don't have it, we can interlibrary loan it, right? And so, and that's it. No, you know, a lot of people aren't doing sort of the, you know.
So they don't browse.
Yeah,
they
don't really like what, so it's sort of a shift in, you know, what people are doing. So then where are you spending your money?
You're seeing the shift in the patron's behavior.
Yeah, that's, you know, and I'm not, we're not saying it's bad or good, we're sort of struggling with like, what are we supposed to be?
How did you collect and develop them when they just come in
for
one specific?
Yeah, just sort of the idea of what we're supposed to be offering the public.
Right.
You know, so.
At least at my little public library, I know we have a, we basically tell patrons if it's newer, if it hasn't been out 6 months, we won't even try. Not want to steal the books from the library, it's just, you know. And so our patrons can't come in if they don't have anything.
Oh, here, try this.
What kind of books do you like? Kind of push out of things. But we find it really helpful for people who are reading that book series. We have 3,000 volumes. We're like the size of this room. And so when they come in for the next kilogram book, we can order that one volume that's going to help. It's really helpful. But we found 6 months.
Yeah.
between collection development at all of the libraries, because otherwise we're just all buying the same books. Bigger libraries more, little libraries fewer, but we're all buying bestsellers or the starred reviews or whatever, which doesn't put much depth in the collection. That if each library set aside a certain percentage of their book budget to develop a certain small part of the collection to give a more depth of that subject matter in the state. I know right now, I have done different subjects in the past. Right now I'm trying to do travel because nobody seems to have the recent travel voters or whatever. And there's a good reason for that.
Yeah.
They go out of date so fast, they're expensive, but I'm trying to concentrate on building our library's collection into travel and putting that together, I must admit, with a travel club, bucket list club at the library, which is my justification for doing it. But if there was some way to coordinate between libraries on what little niche you would like to try and develop on maybe one shelf of your library, it would be really helpful statewide.
This is an example of what they used to call the prospectus approach from the universities of the collection development, where you have to assign a certain percentage of items for each subject area. If you, a university could do that for its education with these students, it seems like if the state had resources that could do it for the public,
there's also a policy in place in a lot of Eastern schools called the East Agreement that we all have to, we all agree to hold a certain part of this big collection so that we can ILL between all of us. We can put something like that in the
I'm envisioning the whole state as a big consortium and then saying, okay, the Chittenden County will focus on these 25 special topics. Whatever. Some sort of collection.
I would be a little concerned though that you're not giving as good service to your local people, because I do think if you're going to have a niche, especially at a small library, it should be a niche that the local people are asking for. So if you're spread out like that, you might have a bunch of books in your town and people aren't traveling or whatever the subject it might be if you pick that. And then you might be meeting the need of somebody in part of the state.
And that's why that the librarian should be the one to select that, not have it be assigned to that library, because so you know what's in, of interest in your area.
Because if that's sort of earning that small library access to all those other specialized collections, then it eases out sort of in the long. I started my library career in a public library in upstate New York, and Vermont is so wonderful compared to New York State, because the layers of bureaucracy, like the different kinds of libraries, never talk to each other except at the state library convention, which was just weird. It was just like very cool, but very bizarre. But the school libraries never talked to the public libraries, and the public libraries never talked to the academic libraries without all these layers of intervention that was the state library structure. And the fact that we can even sit in a room and talk about this, I think, improves library service to Vermont library patrons, and I don't want to lose that. Sorry, I'll get my soapbox now.
I would just say that's really sort of your point at the concerns that I've got to kind of from Rose Memorial. Like, we're so grateful that we have this kind of interlibrary loan network in Vermont where we can help the academics and the smaller libraries, the schools, everybody's in it together. And I would think that it should be a responsibility of this group to really keep an eye on that and make sure that infrastructure is as strong as possible, including software, consortia, how they all work together, the courier, of course, all of that. You know, that just, at Brooks, that's really key for us, because we do a lot of traffic both directions.
Yeah, so along those lines, I think it's not so much of a collection development focus, but an informational focus, like, because I don't necessarily know that Rochester has travel. I mean, I know a lot of things informally, but as part of looking at a broader purpose, like setting up more of an information structure, whatever that is, a, you know, a wiki or whatever, so that
there could be communication about different issues.
Right.
And what different libraries' resources are.
On a statewide level, then, what I think would really help is if we had a directory of, say, collection strengths, something like that, to list off the various libraries and say, have the directory sorted both ways. So, for instance, if you were interested in a certain topic, it would list for you the libraries that have voluntarily said, yes, we're strong in that area. And then around the other way too, list each library and say, these are the strengths, these are the areas that we've agreed to collect, you know, more than usual. And then also, what's being done in the way of having a central website where we could see everybody's catalogs, even if it wasn't a virtual union catalog, even if it was just a link to each, especially all the college libraries, and then, you know, maybe into the more general catalogs for the publics and so forth, and all of that was a one-stop shopping sort of place. Even if you didn't have a search engine yet that could cross-search all of those and come back and tell you who has a particular book you're looking for, even if we had just one website with all that, I think that would be very helpful.
So Clover does search not all library catalogs. We have a lot of them linked in. I'm still adding in more. Every public library that is automated is linked in.
Right.
And then there's a handful of academic libraries and a couple handfuls of school libraries that are linked in. Not all of them have a direct link out to their catalog, but it does search every catalog live. We don't have just a website with a directory of their websites.
So if we could have then, say, in a link that right near that entry point into Clover, then for those of us academics that aren't included in it yet, and then maybe have some sort of idea of what the plan is to get the rest of us connected to.
What is your catalog?
We use TLC, which is the Library Corporation. They're a small vendor. A lot of people aren't they're not one of the major players.
I do periodically, I haven't done it in a while because of the move, but I have been trying to reach out to all of the academic libraries to link everybody in.
Mm-hmm.
UVM opted out of linking in, but I'm hoping to get it. But again, three people in a huge collection, so it was a pretty flooded. But yeah, I can start adding more in again. But there is a participant record for every single library in Clover. It's just a matter of people actually going in and updating their own information. People can add a library website, they can add a direct link to their catalog, but I don't have all of the information to just have a broad update done.
Okay.
But I can send out a reminder on the listserv to log in.
Yeah, and I'll be sure to follow up with you on getting us connected.
And may I just add to that? As a school district that recently became a unified school district, and so then our IT department developed a new website that included all of the new schools in our district now. We've had a lot of changes. Our emails, everything, domain, everything changed. And one thing that keeps happening since we started school in August is that the URL to our catalog changes all the time. And we have to keep updating it on our website. My shortcut to it has been wrong so many times through the school year, I've had to update it. And so putting it on a centralized location, the URL's gonna change until IT has finished working out all of the things that they're doing. So they keep updating it on our website, and so that's why it's better to go right to our school's website and link to our Destiny catalog from there, which is what I do at home all the time because I can't say the favorite for it.
Just sort of an observation about the conversation, it seems like there might be a desire, you know, we all get together in one room and best practices kinds of advice. mice mm-hmm. start moving around, which is great. Like, there's obviously a lot of energy and interest there. And then that's sort of different from if we have a charge to somehow envision, you know, what is interlibrary loan in the state. You know, mm-hmm. so one is more directed and more is on, like, let's all get together and chat. And maybe there would be time for both things at all meetings. I don't know.
So maybe if the priority is to have a specific topic that we tackle at each meeting, and then followed by general conversation of what else do we want to tackle in the future. So any votes for what our first big priority would be?
I like the idea of seeing what we can help people with, you know, like sharing information, like she just said. I think some of the suggestions that are coming up are really great, but they sound also like policy things that I have no decision-making power on. You know, I'm not the head librarian. There's another group that deals with those things. So, like, maybe we could send them some suggestions that we think would be helpful to us, but I'm not sure we can hammer them out here.
Are we concerned about turnaround time? Is anyone concerned about the turnaround time? Increasing it, decreasing it?
I'm sorry.
Turnaround time, how long it takes to be left in the meantime?
I guess
that's
an ongoing, always.
Yeah.
It's always a topic, I guess.
Okay. Is it a priority and should we focus on that?
I guess the only way, I'm a one pickup and delivery week, and sometimes it's 3 weeks before I get a book, depending on whatever the cycle is between Clover randomly selecting a lender who may have just had their books picked up, and it'll be another week, and then another week given to me. You know, the only thing I can do to accelerate that is, you know, sign up for 2 deliveries a week, which would be very helpful, but it would double the cost, or more than double the cost, which we can't afford. So, you know, it's a long wait sometimes, but financially that's not going to be, you know, change. And the same thing with Linden. If I, you know, if an hour after my pickup comes, I get a request, it's going to be a full week before the book leaves house.
There are no policy decisions or procedures we can implement that would speed up the process even incrementally, for instance, if you're banning instead of.
You can't afford to mail out books after you're paying for the courier.
You do much more limited mail. But there were any sites like where it comes, I guess, sometimes in the future.
So I'm thinking that a lot of the issues that are brought up are related partly to budget, partly to finances. So maybe the first big priority should be finding ways to push up the chain the value of interlibrary loan and resource sharing to all the budget makers.
It would be cool if Clover could figure out if I asked for a book today. It would be good for Zimbabwe and Montpelier first because it's today, the first thing that's coming out. The next delivery, as opposed to the books that just went out a week before. Or just go to Clover. You could pick a Clover person you might know, because you can find out when their deliveries are.
Well, you can't override the request from a specific library.
You can, but there's no link between Clover and the courier
system. Right,
I do that all the time. Does everybody, like, as soon as you get a request, you just automatically send that book out? Is that what everybody does? That's not what I do. Because one of the things that, because I'm obviously as a school library, I'm not on the courier system. And so it occurred to me very early on when I started processing Clover requests that I'm going to be incurring mailing back charges for these libraries. And so it's extra steps for me, but I do check to see if the requesting library is on the courier system. And then I look to see, are there a lot of other copies of that book, and are they in libraries that are on the courier system? Yes. So then I say will not send, because I'm saving money for that library.